It's time for Reason.
I mean, if he's a socialist, then being a civil rights attorney, being a lawyer, every bit of money that he brings in, he should probably donate. I mean, like all of it. He doesn't deserve any. He should be back to that level again, right? Because there are people that live at that level, and that's unfortunate for them. He should probably be living on food stamps because all the revenue and profits that he generates from his legal services, he should probably donate and give to somebody else.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I get on my knees and pray. We don't get fooled again. Don't get fooled again.
Oh, welcome into the Voice of Reason. That's what I'm talking about. Making it happen today on the day you look forward to every single week. Welcome in to the Voice Reason on a Friday, broadcasting live out of the heart of the nation here in Wichita, Kansas, on the Big Talker, 1480 on the AM side, 102.5 on the FM side, KQAM. We are on TV as well, KGPT-TV, channel 2610. Good morning, welcome aboard. What's up? Great to have you along today on a Friday, and yes, let's make it a free-for-all Friday. Come on. Whatever's on your mind, bothering you, troubling you, does not matter. Let's have a little fun with it. Let's do our thing, advancing conservatism today on a Friday. Come on. Talk. If you want to join in, we have open lines to you today. Anything that is bothering you, troubling you, I am your political therapist. Let's work through it together just a little bit. Let's make ourselves feel better just a little bit. Here's the good news for you. If you are needing to be therified in some way, shape, or form, there is a story out of the New York Times. Democrats see opening at state level thanks to Trump resistance. Now, the Trump resistance, I don't know exactly who is the Trump resistance. Could be some moderate Republicans, could be predominantly Democrats, obviously progressives. Let me ask you something. If there's a resistance from Democrats, do you think that's going to create an opening at state levels for Democrats to beat Republicans? I don't know if that necessarily helps the cause. See, here's the weird, delusional world that progressives live under, is that if they're upset, then they assume everybody believes the same way. So if they're upset and they are the resistance to Donald Trump, then all of a sudden now everybody is apparently resisting Donald Trump, and therefore they have an opening to be able to win because they're going to win over everybody's votes, including Republicans who may support Donald Trump, but they can't see anybody supporting Donald Trump, so therefore they're going to win at state levels. As you know, predominantly over the entire nation, three-quarters of the country is run by Republican legislature at the statewide level. The majority of governorships in the country are Republicans. The majority of both chambers, by the way, supermajorities in the state legislatures in the country are Republican. And because we have the grassroots campaigns, because conservatism predominantly does better at a local level and a smaller level, because we have a little bit more accountability when it comes to the statewide and local level. So we run the states, which why we can't get past a convention of states kind of boggles my mind. Why we're not able to resist the federal government, kind of do our own thing, kind of troubles me just a little bit. But nonetheless, we do have it. We just need to be able to work on that just a little bit. But Democrats now looking at seeing openings at state levels. I don't know if it's going to work for them. This is the same people, by the way, that think the blue wave's happening and that the Bernie Sandersite momentum is going to be able to carry them through red states like Kansas and this sort of. It's not going to happen. Good luck trying that, but at least you're attempting it. I mean, pat on the head, kudos, A for effort sort of thing, but it's not going to work. It's just not going to happen. So the Democrats see the opening at the state level. What governorships are going to be going towards the blue? I mean, maybe some. I doubt it. Not very many, in my opinion, from what I've seen. But, you know, maybe, I don't know. I mean, if you change, for example, let's say Ohio, and let's say John Kasich is stepping aside, and a Democrat goes in there, honestly, is it really different than what Ohio's seen the last 8 years under John Kasich? I don't know. I mean, you can, I guess, argue that there's a different flavored color in the governorship in Ohio if the Democrat ends up winning. Not sure if it really changes the policymaking that's been happening in Ohio anyways. But, you know, they might actually see a little bit of a blue turn. And then all of a sudden, they just won themselves a seat. And they're all happy and excited about that. as opposed to somewhere like Kansas here, if we do go blue in our, with our governorship, then we would have a little bit of a problem. And as you know about all the issues happening at the statewide level here that we've been trying to focus on, if we end up going blue, then we're going to have a whole other set of issues on our hands that we're going to have to fight. So Democrats, if they do end up trying to see the opportunity at the local blue statewide levels, then kudos to them. I don't see it happening, but, you know, they can at least try. A record number of Democratic challengers are out raising GOP opponents, according to BloombergQuint.com. As they are thinking that they have opportunities at the local levels, now they're starting to see the Democratic challengers in predominantly red districts or historically red districts or at least currently red districts are out raising GOP opponents in fundraising. Does that mean that they're going to pull off a victory of blue waves across the nation? See, the Republican Party could win this very, very easily. And here's exactly what they have. And I'm not talking about just a national election. I'm talking about statewide, local elections that are happening all over the nation in the next month or so. We, as you know, have our primary coming up Tuesday of next week. And here's how we win. Here's how any Republican wins, no matter what level of office that you're running for or that you may be trying to rerun for in the country. Embrace the current Republican Party. Do not apologize for the current Republican Party, meaning Donald Trump and their such. And don't worry about what the mainstream media says. Promote your conservative values. Look, Donald Trump, as you know, is not a technical, philosophical, ideological conservative. That was our biggest issue with him, which is why I did not get on board with him right away at the beginning, because he was not a philosophical conservative. At the same time, he is a populist, and he wants to get things done, and that doesn't discredit conservatism. That opens the door of opportunity for conservatism. For example, at the federal level, how often do conservatives get to go into the White House and have a voice and actually help craft legislation that the president actually gets behind and supports? Even Republican presidents say, you know what, that's a little too extreme. We're not going to go down that road because it's not going to happen. It's not realistic. And you need to back off a little bit, Mr. or Mrs. Conservative. It's just not going to happen. We have a president in there that says, hey, it's a great idea. Let's go do it. Let's make it happen. How many times has Rand Paul been in the White House? How many times has President Donald Trump signed legislation, had a press conference, and say, yeah, Rand Paul is the one that made this happen. This guy's phenomenal. Now let's compare that to how many other presidents before them actually made that happen. If you embrace current Republicanism, you advance your conservative principles, you're not ashamed of those conservative principles, you don't try to win people over by not preaching conservative principles, then you're going to win in a landslide. We've been promoting and plugging and pushing and pushing and pushing really hard for Tuesday's primaries, and the fact that right now we have more seats that are contested with current moderate Republicans with conservative challengers in different races right now than we've seen in a really long time. These incumbents have no idea how to actually come back and campaign against some of these challengers. They don't know how to respond to this conservative movement right now because they've never had this happened to them before. They used to be able to go about promoting that they are the true conservative, that they are the traditional Republican, that they support right to life issues, that they support the Second Amendment, that they support lower taxes. And what's happening right now? Now we have candidates coming out saying, wait a second, your voting record says otherwise, you're not a Republican, you're promoting very moderate left-wing progressive values, and we're going to change you on that. We're going to wake the district up. We're going to grassroots campaign. We're going to knock on doors. We're going to tell people what is actually happening, wake them up to it to where they just don't go to the voting booth. They see only one name on there. They recognize the name because it's been there for a while, and they push the button, and they move on about it and don't even think second about it. It's not going to happen anymore. We have more conservatives challenging the status quo than ever before because of activism. Because of the fact that we're sick and tired of this. Now you're going to tell me to turn around and that Democrat challengers are actually outraising GOP fundraisers across the nation, and that Democrats have a blue wave and that they're looking towards the statewide levels? Are you kidding me? At least here in Kansas, we have more activism on the conservative side than we've ever seen before. And remember, we outnumber progressives 10 to 1. We still, they can bring Bernie Sanders in all they want. They can bring in Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez anytime they want. It's not going to work. It's not going to create the blue wave, and it's not going to make the state purple. If we're able to actually get a Republican governor in again, and we do it for two terms in a row, that will break the mold, that will break the pendulum swinging that's been happening for the last 20, 30, 40 years. And the Democrats will be completely obliterated in the state of Kansas. They will not know what to do with themselves. They are desperate. They have some very weak candidates, by the way, on the left side of the aisle as well. Josh Waddy and Laura Kelly are not the most staunch Democrats that where they can really rally behind and really create an energy. Where's the energy on the left side? The only energy that I see, honestly, is in the second congressional district where they're rallying behind Paul Davis, and right here in the second congressional or the fourth congressional district to where they are rallying behind James Thompson. Those are the only two pieces of momentum that I actually see. I don't see a lot of energy for the governor's race on their side. They're more focused on trying to keep Chris Kobach out and trying to keep the conservatives out and trying to stop the shenanigans with the same brownback policies and the extreme right fringe in the states. They're more concerned about, they're more worried about what we're doing than focusing on what they're doing. And when you do that, if you ever play games, if you ever try and do strategy games, if whatever, if you're paying more attention to your opponent than you are to your own actions, then you're going to lose every time because you're going to slip up. You're not going to pay attention to your actions, and you're going to lose. That's just the matter of fact. That happens every time. I don't see it. I mean, it may just be in the state of Kansas where we've been focusing, but I see a lot of opportunity for us, and they may be trying to outraise. They may be trying to outfundraise. They may be trying to door knock. They may be trying to do whatever they want. It's not going to work. It's not going to happen. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Red Tsunami that's going to continue on as long as we promote the right things. If we're not scared of our shadow, if we don't apologize for who we are, and if we continue to do the right things. 316-721-8255. It's going to be a heck and a half of a show today. Coming up at 7:30, a race that we have not talked a whole lot about coming up on Tuesday. It is one of the Sedgwick County Commissioner races, and Richard Ranzau will be joining us, Sedgwick County Commissioner. He'll be joining us at 7:30 today. Plus, in the 8 o'clock hour, challenger and candidate for Judge Division Number 17, David Lowden, he'll be joining us as well to talk about his racing campaign going into Tuesday. So two more candidates coming up on the slate today for the show, but it is also open lines to you at 316-721-8255. And let's go to the phones this morning, shall we? Line number one. Good morning. What's your name?
Scott.
Hey, Scott. What's going on, sir?
Well, I got problems with all the people who are in office right now because in Sedgwick County, you got county commissioners who were in office when Tyson tried to bring jobs here, and they didn't do anything to get those jobs here. When a man was killed innocently on his porch, we didn't have them doing anything at the city level. And like I said in the past, I got a problem with judges who think they can prosecute from the bench and legislate from the bench, because that's not their job. They're supposed to be impartial and look for a fair trial. And so those are issues that need to be addressed by any of these people who come on your show. And also, they need to be held accountable for those, like I said, who are in office right now. And really, I think all of them need to be voted out.
Well, I mean, that definitely encourages you to go to the voting booth and be able to vote. Now, obviously, a lot of people have a lot of opinions when it comes to a lot of the issues that you addressed, from both the Tyson plant and the jobs coming into the area to the law enforcement and how that's handled when it comes to certain situations that have had, to economic development, to, you know, judges. So you're right. I mean, that if those are the issues that drive you to the voting booth, then I'm glad that you're engaged and I'm glad that you see those issues and that you want to go and vote and make your voice heard.
Also, like, especially on the judges' side, I think they need to have more inquiry trials on some of this stuff, because there's, you know, that thing with the guy getting shot on his porch there, that district attorney needs to be held accountable as well as the supervisor on the scene, because
now, what do you say when you mean the district attorney needs to be held accountable? He did his job, and he read what the laws are right now, and he enforced it based on what the laws are.
The law is in interpretation of it, I don't think was correct. Because I really think that man was killed by a bullet and not by a phone call.
But what caused the bullet? And I don't want to go down that road again about what's, you know, what's causing that whole thing. I don't want to go down that road again. I mean, what the cause of that was, and because I mean, I know we've talked about that many times before, but the law does clearly state that when a law enforcement officer, or anybody, by the way, with their stand the ground laws, if they have a threat or a potential threat to where they feel they're in danger, they have the right to defend themselves. That's the law that was used in order to not prosecute the officer that ended up shooting the individual. And, I mean, that's the law. If we don't like that, then we can work to change that law. But
yeah,
that is
but that
the law.
Law was interpreted a certain way to get him off. That's why it took him so long but to come back to the conclusion.
Well, no, I mean, it took a while. Hold on. It took a while because it was being investigated, and they were looking at everything and looking at all the evidence and the videotapes and everything of that sort. But there's really not a interpretation that you can have or a manipulation of it. It's a stand your ground law, and if you're in threat or you think you have a threat and you need to defend yourself.
I mean, since the man knew he was innocent.
The man does? How does the officer know that?
If he's not back, they'd have tried to charge him with something, and you know it.
It's a stand your ground law, and officers apply to that just as much as the private citizens do. And
if he'd have tried back, you telling me they wouldn't have charged him? Because they know he was innocent. We agree with that. He had nothing to do with any of this.
The officers know he was innocent.
No, I'm saying we know he's innocent now.
Well,
I'm
yeah, 2020 high. Everybody.
He knew he was innocent. He knew he hadn't done anything.
Everybody's got perfect 2020 hindsight. That doesn't mean that, you know,
yeah,
that we have 20.
Just right now, if the cops come in and shoot you and you know you didn't do anything, you got a right to shoot back, yes or no?
If they barge into my house, then yes, I have the right to defend myself.
Okay. All right.
If they barge in, but they didn't barge into his house, he went out onto his deck and then made a movement that he wasn't supposed to be doing, which caused them to be concerned about their potential safety and the safety of everybody else involved in it when they thought there was a hostage situation. Scott, I appreciate the call. I don't want to go down that road again because we've already, you know, kind of gone round and round and round in circles on that. But, I mean, there's no misinterpretation of the law. The fact is the law is the law is the law. And a stand your ground law, when they made the movement that mimicked of having a weapon when they thought he had a weapon because of a hostage situation call that was there, and that's the whole purpose that they were there, then there's a threat, and they ended up defending themselves on what they thought was a threat, and that's the stand your ground law. There's no misinterpretation there. If you don't like that, then we can work to change the law, or you can work to change the law because that's your power as a citizen to be able to make something like that happen, but that's the law, and there's no misinterpretation there. At all. That's just the way it is. Appreciate the call very much, Scott. We always appreciate the dialogue. 24 minutes past the hour. We'll get your phone calls when we come back. Got to take a break on a free-for-all Friday. Let's make it happen today. Stay here.
You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
There's a social media ad floating around for the campaign on Facebook from the group Kansas Conservatives. I have not joined the group. I just saw it, actually, so I'll probably be joining Kansas Conservatives. But it sounds like it's almost a campaign ad for Governor Jeff Colyer, as they say, Jim Barnett. And it's a picture, by the way, of it looks like they photoshopped this. Jim Barnett on a motorcycle with Chris Kobach riding behind him. And it says, Jim Barnett and Ken Seltzer have no chance of winning. A vote for either of them is a vote for Kobach. And the meme says, Jim Barnett trying to help Chris Kobach ride off with the GOP primary. A vote for Barnett is a vote for Kobach. I'm assuming then it would be an ad for Governor Jeff Colyer, as he's just a little behind Kobach, and they don't like that very much, and trying to encourage the unity from the other candidates. I'm sure those candidates don't appreciate that very much. Bottom of the hour news coming up. We'll take some phone calls when we come back. This is The Voice of Reason on a Friday.
It's time for Reason.
Now, if a Republican all of a sudden, worried about an election, comes around and starts wavering on his principles and says, okay, I'm going to give that amnesty, would that soften your heart to the Republicans? Or would you say, yeah, that's nice, great, thanks. That's one less thing that we actually have to address when we're in power, and I'm still going to vote for the Democrat.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Oh, we should try to be reasonable, commonsensical, normal. I don't know. That's the way we at least try to work. Welcome in 316-721-8255 on a Friday, waking you up the best way we know how to do so. Advancing conservatism on a daily basis, because this is the only local conservative talk show in the entire area. And I think we're very proud of that. At least I am, and I'm honored that you tune into us every single day. Thank you so much for that. 316-721-8255. It is a free-for-all Friday today. Whatever's on your mind, along with the great guests. But let's go back to the phones, get your take on the State of Affairs 2018 in the state of Kansas. Let's go to it. Line number one, good morning. What's your name?
Good morning. This is Deacon.
Deacon, what's happening, sir?
Brother, it is beautiful out here today.
That it is. It's nice and cool. And, you know, now that it's August, I'm wondering when we're going to start seeing the not 90-degree weather during the day.
You know, I'm looking forward to that. Cause, you know, I love doing stuff outdoors, camping, fishing, hunting. I don't like to do anything outdoors in the summertime.
Yeah. I mean, I love the nice, warm weather. But, you know, 90s, if it could just stay 70, 75 all year, I would be totally happy with that.
All year long, I'd be in paradise.
There you go. There you go. What's on your mind, my friend?
Well, a couple of things. First off, just because you know who the last caller was, people who don't have the required knowledge to deal with police, I'm going to give you a heads up. When a cop is pointing a gun at you, that is not the time to make your case. That is the time to go, officer, I'm cooperating. And then if you get arrested, when you go to court, that's where you make your case. You don't freaking act like you're going for a gun when everybody's pointing a gun at you.
Well, and just when they tell you to stand still, then you don't drop your hands when they told you to keep your hands up and then turn around and either try and open your door or turn around and try and leave or walk away or do whatever. I mean, that's not the time to do that. And you would think, again, in a whole, you know, being the show of common sense and reason, that would be a commonsensical thing. I mean, look, here's an example. Here's a story for you. In college, I was going from the college town to the town just north of us, Toledo, because I was in Bowling Green at that time, if anybody knows that area. And I was driving up north. It's about 20, 25 minutes. And we're going to watch the Ohio State-Michigan football game, which, by the way, is the biggest rivalry in college football. And myself being a Buckeye was going up there having a good time. We're about ready to go have a college party, watch the college football game. It's going to be great. I'm just getting into the city limits, and it drops down from 50 down to 35. I'm not going 35 because I'm a college kid. End up getting pulled over because I'm speeding. As I get pulled over, the cop comes over, looks into my car, and in my car in the center console there, I have a burnt out cigar because I enjoy smoking my big stogie cigars. And he asks me what it is, and I say, it's just a cigar. It's fine. Well, then, of course, being a college kid, he's concerned that I have other things in my car other than just cigars and things that may not be of the type of legality that was there in Ohio at the time. So he calls in another officer and he says, can I search your car because I want to just check it and make sure of everything. Now, I have one of two ways that I can handle this response. I can say, no, you cannot search my car. I have a right that I think you're a jerk and I don't want you searching it because how dare you assume you college-ist, because you must be a racist against college kids, thinking that I'm just smoking pot everywhere. So you're a college-ist now. And I could have gone down that road and then caused a scene, probably got arrested, and then not watched the football game. Or I can say, sure, officer, here's my car. By the way, there is a humidor underneath my seat with about four new cigars in it that I have not smoked yet, but have at it. And that's the road that I chose. And I went outside of the car, and the two cops came up, and they searched the car, and they found my humidor, and they talked to me about cigars. And then they said that as long as I was voting for Michigan that I wouldn't get a ticket, and I was fine, and off I went. And that's how you handle the situation properly.
I was a much younger person, and another, it's a speeding ticket story. I was running 90 miles an hour in a 55.
Yeah, well done.
I couldn't see a thing, man. You know, I was late for work, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw the state trooper in the median, and I was like, oh, he got me. So I pulled over, put it in park, shut it off, put my hands out the window, because at 90 miles an hour in a 55, that's a felony traffic stop.
Sure.
So I put my hands out the window. He comes up, and at the time I had a 9-inch green mohawk. And he walks up and goes, I just wanted to ask you who does your hair. Turned around laughing and left.
That's outstanding. See? When you actually follow the rule and you actually make their job easier because you know you did something wrong and you recognize that you did something wrong and you make their job easier, then 99% of the time the cop's going to be like, you know what, all right, you realize you did a dumb thing. Don't do it again. Slap on the wrist. Go about your business.
That's it. You know, I'm going to say 99% of the law enforcement out there, they do not want to have an altercation. They want to have a conversation, not an altercation.
Sure.
All right. And if you give them the opportunity to not be a jerk, they're not going to be a jerk. But if they come into a hot situation and you are escalating, they're thinking the worst, because especially in this, you know, atmosphere that we've got today with law enforcement getting killed every other day, you know, they're not going to come into it and put up with your crap.
You know, I could have totally called the officer a collegeist, which I probably should have done at the time, because I totally could have played the victimhood and done a self-identification of, I identify as a pot smoker, even though I'm not a pot smoker, but you're a collegeist for assuming that I am. And I could have gone down that road. How do you think that would have turned out?
Oh, man, that would have been a bad day. Escalating the situation. Now, I mean, you know, I'm also the guy who, if I'm walking down the street, and minding my own business, and a cop comes up and asks me for ID, I'm going to tell him that no, he can't see my ID because he has no probable cause. But I'm not going to be a jerk about it. I'm like, no, man, you don't have the right to do that.
Right.
You know, but you know, it's you can tell them to get bent as long as you do it respectfully.
Right.
You know, don't yell and, you know, start reaching for your waistband and walking away when they're talking to you. You've got to know how to handle a situation. You know, it's like being married. You don't go in and yell at your wife all the time.
Right.
You know, you talk to her with some sense. You got to do that with everybody.
And if you're arguing and you have a disagreement, then you don't walk in and say, like, honey, I can't believe this. I want to crap. And you go in, honey, you know, because remember the whole happy wife, happy life thing. You say, you know, honey, we need to talk about this a little bit.
Right. It's like, you know, this is.
At least that's the way I handle it.
I think I'm right, and this is where I think you're wrong. You know, you can't just go and be a bulldog. It just doesn't work.
Sure. Well, I agree, Powerpuff. It was a great time.
Oh, man. That's you know, I self-identify as a Powerpuff girl.
There you go. Self-identify as a Powerpuff girl. I love it. You can appreciate the call, my friend, very much so. 316-721-8255. By the way, talking about the evil, terrible cops that just hate people and probably always do the bad thing and the wrong thing and just don't care about individuals. I don't know if you saw the story. Hat tip to KWCH on this one. A routine check at a Hayesville gas station resulted in Sergeant Randy Nowak said that he noticed some people sleeping in a car in the parking lot and went to check to make sure they're okay, nothing was wrong, making sure everyone's safe, and the main reason we're out here, found out that a lady was trapped, ran over and assisted her to get help out of the car, and ended up finding out that they were homeless. What did they do? Paid for a hotel room for the homeless individuals to stay in instead of sleeping in their vehicle. The family was going out to get a bit of rest in their car before continuing out to Iowa, but Sergeant Nowak decided to take them to the hotel next door. He bought them a room for the night with his own money. Quote, they were pretty excited. It was nice to see to lay down in a bed after a long day that they had driven, and their little one stretched out in the bed, instead of actually sleeping in the back of a car. So they are the cops that are terrible, that don't really care about the individuals, that don't care about people, and there you have the story. Look, as we say before, there are, instead of grouping and generalizing, which the progressives love to do, they love to generalize. And we've said this many times before. Remember, you're not, according to them, you are not an individual. You are not a human being. You are part of the group. That's how you should identify. You are part of the group. If you are gay, then you don't have a personal identity. Who cares that you're a good person, that you have good character, whatever the case is? No, you are part of that LGBTQ community, and therefore that's what you identify with. That means that you should support everything the LGBTQ community supports. Therefore, you should vote the way that they tell you to vote. You should support the way that they tell you to support. You should be offended by the things they tell you to be offended by, and that's it. End of story. You can't have a personal identity. You can't have a personal mindset or a personal opinion. You support what they do, because if not, then you are a betrayal to that movement. If you are a cop, then you're generalized. According to the progressives, then you are the pig that's on the socks of Colin Kaepernick. Then you are the person that pulls that trigger because you're concerned, and that you pull it prematurely, and then you end up harming somebody, and then all cops are bad because of that, and you hate people. That is the mentality that we live under today. And by the way, this does happen sometimes on the fringe on the right as well. Not nearly as much, but it does on occasion. And we need to be careful with that. It's not a groupthink mentality. We don't live with groupthink mentality, with mob-like mentality. This is why so many people love the concept of supporting democracy. You hear about these democratic socialists. I saw a meme yesterday on social media that said, democratic socialism, we actually still believe in capitalism. We just don't believe in excessive capitalism, and we support the mentality of everybody having a voice under democracy. Well, number one, socialism's still stupid. And number two, democracy is still stupid, because democracy is mob rule. So you support mob rule. You support the fact that no one actually has a singular voice. You don't support the fact that everybody can have a say and everybody's rights are protected. You believe in the mob rule, to where, yeah, you can have your voice, but as long as your voice is louder than somebody else, then you get to overrule that person. That's what you believe in, right? Now tell me how that's better for society. Tell me how, for when you look at somebody, you don't look at them as the individual and say, oh, you know what, they're really good. You look at them and say, oh, look, they have a lot of money. They're rich. They're the top 1%. They should be paying for my stuff. They're probably a terrible, horrible person that stole that wealth from somebody else, and now they're reaping it while they're taking advantage of other people who work below them, because that's what rich people do. Instead of saying, oh, look, they're charitable. Look at the Koch brothers, for crying out loud. How many things in the community here in Wichita do they donate and do they contribute to and that they fundraise for and that they give? How many YMCAs in the Wichita area have different pools or different portions of the YMCA that are donated to and created because of the Koch brothers? Koch Arena that happens here, to where we can have entertainment and sporting events. How many things in the community do the evil, terrible rich people have that actually they contribute and donate to the community? Because they're that terrible and horrible individuals, right? 316-728-255. It's time for us to stop the group think mentality and actually start looking at people as individuals the way that it was intended to be. 48 minutes past the hour. Take a break. Wrap up hour number one on a free-for-all Friday. Stay right here.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Minutes to the top of the hour as we wrap up hour number one already. This show goes by way too fast. I still haven't gotten to half of what I wanted to talk about. That's all right. I love the free-for-all Friday. Anything you want to talk about, it is open to you. We do have a lot of election stuff to get to today as well. 316-721-8255. But as you know, it is a Friday. It is a free-for-all Friday, which means it is also a fried chicken Friday, brought to you by the Inman Harvest Cafe in downtown Inman, just north of Hutch. 620-585-6925, and you can smell the fried chicken floating down yonder this way. You can have biscuits and gravy with the sprinkles of fried chicken. One of these days, I'm going to try that. Katie's on the line with us here. Katie, good morning to you. Happy Fried Chicken Friday.
Good morning, Andy. Happy Fried Chicken Friday. I don't think you're smelling chicken. I think you're smelling bacon.
Well, see, that works too. And then you know what you could do is, one of these days, all right, here's my mind thinking again, which is a dangerous thing at time, but biscuits and gravy with sprinkled bacon on top.
Yes, I do that.
You do that, and that sounds amazing.
Yeah, and it's really good, and I like to take a little cheddar cheese and a little green onions and put on top, too.
See, that's kind of what I'm talking about. That's the way we roll. Well, today, you guys have a big day. It's because today's one of your most funnest days of the entire week, and yes, funnest is now a word because of this.
Is the
fact that, yes, you can have fried chicken. You have two buffets going on today from 11 to 1, the big one from 5 to 8 o'clock tonight, along with the fried chicken, along with the roasted beast that you have every single week. What else you got on the slate for us?
Today we're going to have German lasagna.
What is that?
And so that's like a, yeah, that's like a, our German sausage that we get right down the street at the grocery store here. And then we cook that up and slice it, and it's got sauerkraut and then a white sauce and cottage cheese, and it's layered up just like a, I mean, it's a lasagna, so lasagna noodles, and it's layered up, and it's really tasty. Like, you don't even, it's not like overly sauerkrauty. You can tell it's in there, but it's not like, you know, exclusively sauerkraut, so really tasty.
Yeah, then, I like my German, yeah, my German
know,
food
right?
like that. Yeah, pretty good.
Yeah, it's really good. And so then we're also going to have a zucchini casserole that's got zucchini, chicken, carrots. There's some yellow squash in there, onions, celery. And then it's topped off with either, you know, we kind of change it up. So I'm not sure whether it'll have like a something crumbly on top, okay? So breadcrumbs or maybe some stuffing, or maybe some cornflakes. Who knows? We're going to top
nice.
It up.
Very good. I like that. That sounds delicious.
Maybe we'll try one of each and see what everyone likes the best.
There you go. Put both of them out and just kind of do a free-floating poll on that one.
Yeah.
So I like that. Well, good. That's going to be a heck of... Now, that's going up for both the lunch and the dinner, correct?
Right. Yes. And so, and then besides that, all of that stuff, then from 5 to 8 in the evening, we'll have our famous roast beef out there, which is, it's slow roasting, so... really yummy. We'll get it out of the oven this afternoon sometime. And pie.
No, we got to have the pie. Got to have the pie.
Gotta talk about pie.
That's right.
I got to go all the way up here. I'm running. Woo! Okay. So today's pies are coconut cream, chocolate cream, sour cream raisin, rhubarb custard, lemon meringue, cherry, regular custard, pumpkin, and peach.
That's what I'm talking about. Nice big scoop of homemade ice cream on top of those. And that is that free slice of pie that happens just in the evening from 5 to 8 o'clock for that buffet. When you get there, grab that slice of pie, put it on your table before you end up going and getting the rest of the amazing food there. But get that free slice. And that is going to be quite delicious today to begin a brand new weekend.
Yeah, and you know, if you don't have a table to sit at when you very first get here, still get your pie. You can hang on to it, or there's like plastic forks sitting right there next to the pie if you want to just, you know, go ahead and eat your pie while you're waiting for a table. We have people do that too.
See, that's kind of what I'm talking about. That's the way we roll. So,
I
got to ask. I mean, we got about 45 seconds here, but I got to ask: is the talk of the town as everybody comes in? Tuesday is election day. Does everybody kind of seem fired up, ready to go?
Yes. Well, we do have. They're going to be discussing that at the chamber meeting this morning. I hear about it quite a bit. My husband is running for First District Congress, so that makes it a little bit more. We do hear a little bit more about it in here than what
usual
we
sometimes.
Usually do.
Sure.
So
I love it.
We've been actually all over the state. This weekend, and it's going to be kind of a crazy time. So.
You guys have been extremely busy, and good luck to you guys with that race on Tuesday. That's going to be a lot of fun to see how the primaries turn out.
I'm excited.
I love it, Katie, with the Inman Harvest Cafe, 112 South Main Street, downtown Inman. It is the Fried Chicken Friday. You guys enjoy. Have some fun with breakfast. We'll check in with you here in just a couple of hours.
All right, thanks. We'll talk to you later.
Very good. Always a pleasure there. That's Katie with the Inman Harvest Cafe. Wrapping up hour number one. We'll open up lines to you. Kicking off hour number two right here on a free-for-all Friday on The Voice of Reason.
It's time for Reason.
I mean, if he's a socialist, then being a civil rights attorney, being a lawyer, every bit of money that he brings in, he should probably donate. I mean, like all of it. He doesn't deserve any. He should be back to that level again, right? Because there are people that live at that level, and that's unfortunate for them. He should probably be living on food stamps because all the revenue and profits that he generates from his legal services, he should probably donate and give to somebody else.
This is The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I'll get on my knees and pray. We don't get fooled again. Don't get fooled again.
That's what I'm talking about. Welcome into The Voice of Reason, hour number two of The Voice of Reason, broadcasting live out of the heart of the nation here in Wichita, Kansas. on the Big Talker, 1480 on the AM side, 102.5 on the FM side, KQAM, simulcasting on TV, KGPT-TV, channel 2610. Good morning. Welcome aboard. It's great to have you along today on a Friday. What the heck? Let's make it a free-for-all Friday. Come on. You know how we do it every single week. That means it's up to you. You choose the discussion. You choose the topic. I just sit back, hang out, and do my thing on a Friday morning. Talk. If you want to join in, we have the Facebook Live feed up and rolling, which a lot of people checking out today. Hey, welcome aboard. We love having you there. Leave a comment, share, like it, share it onto your own page, do whatever you do. Facebook kind of still being a little odd with us as they haven't done it yet this morning, but lately, just at least once or twice in the morning, they're like, oh, we're going to temporarily mute your video or your audio because you may have some copyrighted material on there, or oh, we're going to ban your video because you have copyrighted material, and then you got to contest it, and it's a whole drawn out thing, and it's a little ridiculous, and I still say hashtag fake news with Facebook trying to shadow ban us on there. So nonetheless, go there, facebook.com/1480KQAM. Like it, share it onto your own page, just leave a comment. Let's have a little fun on there today. Coming up in about 20 minutes, we have Sedgwick County Commissioner Richard Ranzau as we talk about their race. I have not discussed that race a whole lot lately, and we do need to get that info out for everybody in that area of the Sedgwick County Commission. We'll talk about it. Now, I did reach out to his opponent as well, Hugh Nix. I saw that they saw it on Facebook. They did not respond. Not sure what that means. doubt that he's going to come onto the program, but I did extend the offer for Hugh Nix to come onto the program as well, which is the primary opponent for Sedgwick County Commissioner Richard Ranzau. But we will talk with Richard Ranzau coming up at the bottom of the hour, getting ready for Election Day 2018 for primary season, baby, next Tuesday. I appreciate, if you remember yesterday, listener Eddie called in and talked about getting a sample ballot so you can look and see what the ballot's going to look like, and you can kind of prepare and plan for what it's what you're going to do when you go to the voting booth and you actually cast your ballot. He dropped off a copy, and I appreciate that very much. So I have here a sample copy of the ballot. And I was going through looking, and it's very interesting to see. First off, there are a lot of governor's candidates on the Republican side because all the high school kids are still on here as well. So you have Joseph Teterra Jr., you have Jim Barnett, you have Jeff Colyer, Chris Kobach, Patrick Kucera, Tyler Ruzick, and Ken Seltzer, all on the ballot. So there's a plethora of individuals that you can actually vote for, but you can see it exactly how it's for. But it has themselves as the governor's candidate and their running mate on the ballot. Here's the big part at the very beginning for the 4th Congressional U.S. United States Representative 4th District. It does look like it's very difficult to be able to see, or it could potentially, if you're not paying attention, you could easily make the mistake where it says Ron Estes, Rep. Ron Estes, or Ron M. Estes. The challenger being Ron M. Estes, who does not like Ron Estes, and trying to challenge him just to throw it off. Now, I've heard potentially that this could mess up a lot of people, could confuse a lot of people if they're not paying attention, and it may or may not have already done so. With some of the early voting, we have some of the highest early voting that we've seen in a really long time. We are very energized, and it's time for us to not only be energized, but also be very informed when we go and vote to make sure that we vote for the right. Now, I mean, if you want to vote for the Ron M. Estes, then all the power to you, I guess, but not sure why, because he hasn't even done anything. They have no grassroots campaign, have no idea what the platform actually looks like, but Rep. Ron Estes is on the ballot and is the first one. It is the top one, and be very careful when you do that vote because it could potentially damage the election just a little bit. So kind of an interesting one there. If you want a sample ballot, what I may do is I may scan it and send it to people if you would like a copy of it as well, and that way you can see what the sample ballot will look like. I'm already getting messages on Facebook saying, hey, can you share that? Can you post it? Yes, I will make a copy of the sample ballot. I will post it on Facebook. I'll email it or send it to you if you'd like, so that way you can have a copy, you can look it over, and that way you can be a little more comfortable with it and familiar with it when you actually go to the voting booth on Tuesday to actually vote. So yes, it is front and back. It is two pages there, and that way you can see the judges' races. You can see all the candidates there. You can see the Ron Estes one. You can see the governor's race and see exactly what this will all look like. So really excited about it. Election Day coming up on Tuesday, and I know we're geared up and excited for that one. We'll talk about some more of that in a second, but it is a free-for-all Friday. Let's go ahead and take a phone call and get your thoughts and calls. 316-721-8255, line number one. Good morning. What's your name? Uh-oh. I think we have an issue there. Let me try. Now, at the top of the hour, we had a fun little hiccup with the phone line. It started, like, doing the whole little rave, like, strobe light thing going on here. And I tried to reset it, but I don't know if it's actually going to work or not now. So let's go. Let's try it again. Line number one. Good morning. What's your name? See, we're going to get the hollow thing. All right. During the break, I'll reset the phones. Call me back in about 10 minutes, and we'll try and get that going again. Not sure what's going on. 316-721-8255, and we'll try and get something. I see some calls trying to come in. Let's see if we can at least try and get them on here. Line number one. Nope, not going to be able to get it. All right. Don't call yet. We'll reset the phones. We'll try that after the break, and we'll try and get this going again. So I don't know. You know, technology. What do you do? The big news of the day, of course, when it comes to the governor's race, as we get to, I mean, that is really kind of the most heated race in the state of Kansas is the governor's race. And Governor Colyer, I'm sure you saw the news that came out, said Chris Kobach should pay personal legal fees after trial over the voter ID laws that closed up to close to $26,000. Now, I'm almost wondering if this is not some sort of political stunt, and nothing against Governor Colyer here, but I'm wondering if this is somewhat of a political stunt to say, you know, Chris Kobach, I know you were defending it under the Secretary of State. I know that this was your job and the administration supported it and the office was the one that was actually in court, but you lost and you had a contempt fee, so therefore you should probably have to pay the personal pay the legal fees personally of the $26,000 as opposed to actually using the credit card for the state and the taxpayers actually funding this. Now, of course, the progressives are going to absolutely love that idea. They're going to love it because they want Chris Kobach to pay and be punished as much as they possibly can when it comes to this race. I don't think that should be the case. I really don't. This was a legal argument. For the Secretary of State office, not for Chris Kobach personally, but for the actual office. And therefore, whatever fees came along with that, unfortunately, yeah, I mean, it's our taxpayer money, but it would go towards the legal fees of the actual case. That's just the way it is. I don't know another case to where an individual that's in the government that's actually trying to fight for something for the government and the administration's actually doing it. And then they say, oh, you lost, so you got to pay the legal fees yourself. I've never seen a case like that. But, of course, it is just days before a primary election. This is the, quote-unquote, front runner now, according to the polls that we've been able to see. And this is an attack of, hey, you know what? How dare that you spend government money and taxpayer money in order to pay for legal fees of an issue that a lot of people don't support and a lot of people don't agree with, and you should probably have to pay for these out of your own pocket. I just don't see how that makes any sense to me in any way, shape, or form. This is kind of a non-issue going into an election. I mean, again, nothing against Governor Colyer, but this almost seems like almost a state of one last cheap shot before the primary. One last way to say, look what Chris Kobach's doing. He's doing things that you don't like. And oh, by the way, he's making you pay for it out of your own pocket. And that's kind of a bad thing. And I just don't see that. If it was a personal issue and a personal vendetta, then I can maybe see that. This is the office of the Secretary of State for the state of Kansas. The office is the one that's actually promoting this. This is part of the government. And if the government didn't like that, then the other branches of the government, the executive branch, the legislative branch, should have come out and said, yeah, you know what? You're not allowed to actually do this case. You're not allowed to take this to court. You got to listen to the ACLU, and that's it. And we're not going to spend the money in the courts to be able to fight this. And if you want to, then you can go off and do this personally on your own time. They should have come out with that clarification before the case actually begun. That didn't happen. The government has supported it. It was through the Secretary of State's office. And guess what happened now? We need to pay through the Secretary of State's office. A little non-issue that, of course, now during a heated political season for the governor's race is going to be brought up right before the primary when they feel it's an attack on the front runner. Your thoughts on that? We'll get your phone calls when we come back. I will try and reset the phones. We'll see if we can't get you on here. It's hard to have a free-for-all Friday when you can't even get through the phone line. So stay tuned. We'll try and reset the phones. We'll get your phone calls when we come back. This is The Voice of Reason. Yeah.
The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Minutes past the hour. Welcome into the Voice Reason. It is great to have you along today on a free for all Friday. All right, let's give it a try. Give me a call, 316-721-8255. 316-721-TALK. We'll test out the lines, make sure that we're good to go and hunky dory. Making it happen today on a Friday. Let's give it a try. Line number one. Good morning. What's your name?
It's Jim.
Hey, there we are. We got it going, Jim. How are you, sir?
Real good. Andy, I want to tell you my opinion.
Yes.
Sam Brownback was probably one of the best governors we've ever had, if not the best.
Sure.
And his tax plan would have worked if they'd have just given it one more year, but our rhinos didn't see fit. And you know, he vetoed that bill twice. And look how Colyer has tried to separate himself from one of the best governors we ever had.
That's very true. Now, I would agree with you. I am a big fan of Governor Brownback. Now, I had my issues with him, and I think that he could have pushed a little bit harder when it came to government spending in order to make his tax plan actually work. Because the biggest issue, as you know, was not the fact that we cut taxes, was the fact that we didn't cut spending in order to compensate for the less revenue to come in until the economy came back up and we saw more revenue come in from the GDP and the economy actually growing. And that was the flaw that he didn't push very hard, and he was too nice in trying to not encourage the legislature from doing what they needed to do from that. But I'm with you. I was a very big fan of Governor Brownback, and Governor Colyer, I think, made a bit of a mistake on the campaign trail by coming in and trying to distance himself and have his new unique style of things, which I know he wants to be kind of on his own and have his own deal, which is great. But at the same time, when you distance yourself from someone like that, then, you know, sometimes you're going to run into some hard problems.
Well, look at how bad the economy was and everything. I think if that tax thing would have still been in place, with our economy now starting to come around, it would have worked.
Sure.
And well, anyway, I think we better take a chance here. We got Kobach, and I'm telling you, he's the only one that will do what he says he's going to do, I think.
Sure. Well, I mean, anyway, you're spot on. And I mean, just imagine if we would have kept the tax breaks that Brownback had, and we were on that path to zero, and we would have continued on with almost a zero income tax for everybody in the state, and just would have gone to a fair tax with sales tax, and then Trump comes in with his economy. Imagine where we could potentially be right now for the state of Kansas.
That's exactly right. Thank you so much, Andy. Hey. I'm proud of you at your age. Just the way you think.
Well, Jim, I appreciate that. I really appreciate the kind words. That means a lot. Thank you much. I mean, you're right. I mean, just imagine what we could do in this state right now. And we were doing it, too. We were doing it. And that's what the media fails to tell you, is that before we did the retroactive largest tax increase in state history, before we went down that road and we implemented, if you remember, it was implemented in July of last year, which means we had that first 6 months of the year where it wasn't doing. If you remember, the economy was coming up for 10 months in a row. 10 months in a row leading up to that July. We were seeing tax receipts higher than projections before we raised taxes. Is anybody talking about that? The economy was coming back. The tax rates were low for individuals. People were actually seeing the opportunity for job growth. Then Trump comes in and starts working on the economy at the national level, giving us incentives to actually do something great. We were on the road to really jump and take off here in the state of Kansas. For 10 months in a row, they're all happy because now, if you remember, after the tax increase in July of last year, every single month, the big news is, oh, look at that, tax receipts higher than projections. Tax receipts higher that we're bringing in more money. We're bringing in more money. Look at this. It's all working. It's doing great. If you remember, we already were seeing that. We were seeing tax receipts higher than monthly projections at the state level for 10 months straight leading up to before we even started raising taxes. If we would have continued on that road, if we would have allowed the tax breaks to stay intact, if we would have allowed the lower tax rates to be there, then we would be in a heck of a lot better position than we are right now. We would have had the money still coming in. We'd still obviously have the debates on where the spending would go and where the money would actually be going. But they talk about right now that we'd be so much, we're so much better off, and all the tax money coming in higher than what we anticipated. It would have been even more so now under the Trump economy, after the tax breaks actually took place at the federal level, than we're seeing even right now. We kind of shot ourselves in the foot a little bit. And I agree with you. I know that it's unpopular, and I get Governor Colyer wanting to distance himself a little bit because of the whole polling, and he's the third least popular governor in the country, being Governor Brownback, and how everybody hated him, and it was the Brownback policy, and there was a negative countertone behind it. And I get on the campaign trail, you try and shy away from that and try and, you know, do your own thing, which I get. I understand it, but at the same time, don't listen to the rhetoric of what the media is telling you on popularity, and who cares about popularity. If the policies work, then embrace it, and conservative policies always work, and therefore embrace it. Embrace it and say, yeah, we're going to cut taxes, we're going to go back to the tax plan, but then we're going to take it to the next step and do what we failed to do, and we're going to cut spending in order to compensate for that, get the state government intact, and then allow the private GDP to grow and flourish the way it actually needs to. 316-721-8255. Let's take a phone call here. Line at number two. Good morning. What's your name?
Hello, this is Mary.
Good morning, Mary. How are you today?
Oh, I'm fine.
Good.
But I was just going to tell you that the Wichita Eagle ran a front page negative, a front page article, and another whole page and a half negative on Kobach.
They're starting to get a little scared, aren't they? They're realizing that he has been the front runner a little bit. His polling numbers are up higher than anybody else's, and they're starting to panic that that could be the Republican candidate for the governor. And out of anybody they despise, they hate Kobach probably even more than they did Governor Sam Brownback.
Well, why does the ACLU not want the ID? Why are they against the voter ID, do you think?
Because they would love illegal immigrants to be able to vote. And that's really what it comes down to. The progressives, the Democrats, and the ACLU that support the progressives and the Democrat agenda, they love the idea of illegal aliens voting. Look, they're the ones that are fighting for the no separating children at the border. They're the ones trying to fight for the and defend quote unquote human rights when someone comes here for alleged asylum seeking. Sometimes it's true, sometimes it's not true. And they want people to come here. They want the open borders. They would love people to be placed in certain districts that are predominantly deep red and then start changing that tide a little bit. And they would love illegal aliens to vote. And the fact that we just want to verify your name and who you are and make sure that you are who you are to go and vote, they hate that idea because that kind of kills the opportunity for others to vote when they're not supposed to.
But I'm telling you, if you care for the Constitution, you better get out and vote for Kobach and Ranzau.
Well, there we go. I appreciate it very much, Mary. Thanks so much for the phone call. And there you go, Richard Ranzau, Chris Kobach, a vote right there. Speaking of, we'll have Richard Ranzau coming on the show here in the next break when we come back, talking about the Sedgwick County Commission race right here in the area. Appreciate the phone calls. We'll take a break, take some more when we come back. This is The Voice of Reason.
Headline just isn't enough.
Is that all you got?
It's time to wake up the right way.
All right, all right, all right.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier on the Big Talker, 1480 AM and 102.5 FM, KQAM.
Welcome back in, doing the thing, waking you up the best way we know how to do so, which is the right way. You can interpret that one however you'd like to do so. Your only, one and only local conservative talk show in the area, which we're very proud and honored to be. Welcome into The Voice of Reason. 316-721-8255. 316-721-TALK. If you want to join in, 36 minutes past the hour as we're getting into election coverage. Look, this is my Super Bowl, baby. I love election time. We're trying to cram in as many candidates as we can to talk to them going into it because you need to know the voter, the constituent, you need to be engaged, you need to be informed in exactly what they stand for and what their records are. And the next guest that I have on the show, we've had him on many times before, really excited to have him back as we talk about this race. This is going to be a big one, and for anybody living in this district, it's kind of important. And one man who, you know what his record is, you know exactly what he stands for, because he is not shy to actually tell you about that. Sedgwick County Commissioner Richard Ranzau on the line with us. Richard, how are you, my friend?
Doing very good, Andy. Thanks for having me on.
Hey, always great to talk to you. How's the campaign going so far?
Hey, it's going great. You know, we've been out going door to door, talking to people, and getting a fantastic response. So we're just looking forward to Tuesday.
Good, good. No, absolutely. I know it's kind of gotten a bit of a heated race, and I know your opponent, Hugh Nix, has kind of gone on the attack a little bit. But talk about what's been the discussion so far, what's been some of the attacks, and obviously, I mean, we know where you stand, but refresh some people's minds on, I mean, what your platform is and what you've done in the county commission.
Well, I'm a staunch supporter of the taxpayer, and I believe in good government. That's a government that's efficient, effective, and accountable. That means when we get your tax dollars, we're going to spend it on things that work, and we're going to spend it wisely. And so in order to do that, you have to ask questions. You have to challenge a system, and then you got to push back sometimes in order to get good solutions. And that's what I've been doing. Now, when you do that, it kind of opens you up to the opportunity for unfair criticism, and people can take and twist the truth and tell half-truths or sometimes flat-out lie about it, particularly when they're desperate because they know I have a significant track record of results. And so that's kind of where we're at now. We're just trying to work hard and make sure people know the truth.
Mm-hmm. Talk about your stint in the Sedgwick County Commission so far and where we've come as a commission. I mean, I've been in the area for about 3 years, and I've seen you, and I've seen Sedgwick County Commissioner Jim Howell and Carl Peterson when he was there, and the kind of the evolution that we've seen in the county to where I think we've gone in a really good direction. We've capped our debts as the county. We've tried to limit some of the spending. We've cut some of the regulations. I mean, have you seen the same trend as well, that we've kind of moved in the right direction?
Well, I think we have, and it particularly started moving back when we had the conservative majority a few years ago in 2015 and 16, and we got the ball rolling in the right direction. We've got a new county manager, and that has helped as well. Some of the things, there are some people who want to repeal some of that stuff. You know, last year there was an attempt to change the debt limit and to also repeal the mill levy decrease that's coming in 2023 as a result of our fiscal responsibility. So we have to be careful as we move forward that we don't try and go backwards again.
Well, and remember, I don't know if an automatic repeal and we actually end up decreasing it like we're supposed to, and they repeal something like that, that would be considered a tax increase, would it not?
Well, that's what I would classify it as. There's always people who want taxpayer money, who feel entitled to other people's money, and they're always out there asking for money, and particularly the last year and a half or so, and you've got to push back and fight back. I think we need to focus on our core services so we can get some quality results, and I think we've done that.
Mm-hmm. Talk about some of the upcoming projects that you think we need to be focused on as a county. I know that we're in the middle of the budget debates. We have Sedgwick County Commissioner Jim Howell on every Wednesday talking about the upcoming meeting each week. But talk about right now your stance on and your take on the county budget as we go into the budgetary process and what the upcoming projects may be.
Well, probably one of the biggest projects we're looking at is more space for the sheriff and the DA, and there's been a big old discussion about the administration building, whether we need it or not, and if so, how much we're going to spend. The one thing I want to look at is make sure we don't slide back in the habit of borrowing money unnecessarily, because that leads to increased bond payments, and that can accumulate over time. It kind of makes us lazy, and we borrow a lot of money, and we spend a lot of money on interest unnecessarily. So we've got to be very, very careful about that. There's appropriate time to bond, and we do that. We borrow money for big projects, but you don't want to overuse that because then you end up actually digging yourself in a hole. So I'm kind of looking, you know, one of the things I look at when I look at budgets, I look at the short-term benefit, but I also look at the long-term consequences or benefit. And, you know, sometimes we don't do that in government because our budgets go from year to year and elected officials just look at the next election, and they don't necessarily look long-term, and I think sometimes that can have some unintended consequences. So
sure, sure. No, absolutely. Talking to people, knocking on the doors, doing the campaigning right now, and just kind of feeling out the constituents, what's been one or two of the hot topic issues that people have been concerned about at the county level?
Well, it's very easy. There's been two top questions I get all the time, and the first one is kind of can be a sensitive subject, but it's really about unethical behavior and corruption in the county, and specifically with one of my commissioner friends. And so that is the number one question that gets brought up. I think my constituents appreciate the fact that I've taken a stand on that issue, and in fact, I'm the only commissioner to do so publicly, and they appreciate that. And then the second question I get is, do I support Donald Trump? And 90% of the people who ask me that question want me to say yes, and so it's been very, very interesting.
It's odd that during a county commission race, that would be the issue. Hey, do you make sure you support Donald Trump? Because, I mean, I think that's where people's minds are right now, is that we have this national movement of conservatism in the Donald Trump style, and either you're on board or you're not. And I think even the local elections, it sounds like that's having an impact on stuff.
Well, I think there's a lot of people, in particular, we're talking about Republican primary, who want elected officials that will stand up and challenge the status quo and challenge the establishment, ask questions, and try to do things the right way and not let the swamp, so to speak, control things. We have our own local oligarchs, you see. We talk about oligarchs everywhere. We have our own local oligarchs who like to control government here as well, and I think the average constituent who pays taxes and works hard, you know, wants somebody to actually stand up and ask questions.
Sure. No, absolutely. We're talking to Richard Ranzau, Sedgwick County Commissioner, coming up for the race on Tuesday. Talk a little bit. I know you can't go into some detail about the ethical, unethical behaviors and some of the shenanigans going on with the county right now, but is there a feel of, from an outsider looking in, it seems like there's a bit of maybe instability when it comes to the county commission because of some of this. Are you getting that feeling from inside as well? And do you think that there's going to be an end date on some of this pretty soon?
Well, behind the scenes, there really is. There's a lot of bad dynamics going on. There's a lot of, just politicking far beyond anything I've ever experienced. And when you have people voting, not because of the merits of an issue, but for, you know, trading votes or making alliances for political reasons and supporting things that they normally wouldn't, it really is a toxic atmosphere. And I don't think the people can truly appreciate it unless you're in there on a day-to-day basis. And I've been in now 7 years, almost eight. And I've been on the losing side of a lot of votes, and that's not the issue. For the first 6 years, you know, I've won some, I've lost some, but I've never experienced anything like this, and it's not good government. It's really bad for our community. But behind the scenes, there are people who want things and make campaign contributions, sometimes a lot.
Sure.
And, you know, some people support campaigns because they want limited government. They want the government not to pick winners and losers, but there's some people who actually do want the government to pick winners and losers, and they'll put a lot of money into it, and they'll really attack candidates who stand up for what's right. And so it's really is a bad situation.
Sure. We're talking with Richard Ranzau. We have requested and extended the offer for your opponent to come on the show as well. Haven't heard anything back yet. But talk about some of the differences. Obviously, we know your record. You've been in there, as you mentioned, 7-8 years into the county commission. But the differences between you and your opponent, what's kind of the makeup look like as we go into the voting booth on Tuesday?
Well, it's very interesting because he's actually running as a conservative and someone who should ask questions and make good decisions and do research well. Everybody knows that's exactly what I do. But let's make no mistake about it. This election, or the reason I have an opponent, is really about corporate welfare or cronyism, whatever you want to call it. Certain business getting millions of dollars of taxpayer subsidies unnecessarily just because they can, just because they have people in office that will do it. And that's the single issue that this is really about. And they'll try to talk about other things and try to divert the attention away, but that's really what it's about. And that's unfortunate because there are so many other issues, but particularly when it comes to economic development, you know, there's two ways. Even Donald Trump and the federal government understand this. You control taxes or lower taxes, and you control regulation. That's what they're doing at the federal level. And look, the economy is taking off.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't focus on those issues here locally. It's only about incentives. And so, you know, whether you agree with me or disagree with me, I do my research on these things. And I'm telling you, the local elected officials get played on an almost constant basis.
Sure, absolutely. Richard Ranzau with the 4th District for the County Commission for Sedgwick County. Talk about your district lines. Where all do you represent in case anybody doesn't know?
Well, I've got the Mays, Valley Center, Park City, and then it goes down to north and central Wichita, all the way over from Wichita State over to Riverside and Benjamin Hills and that area over in there. And so it's a pretty big district. And very diverse district. I'm really proud to serve this district, and look forward to do it again for another 4 years, I hope.
Sure. Well, we got just about a minute or so left, but talk about one last word to the listeners as they go to the voting booth. What message do you want them to take away with?
Listen, if you want somebody to stand up and fight for you and challenge the system, you got to get out and vote. Don't take this election or any other election for granted. Get out there, vote. Early voting has already started, and get out and do it, and stand up to the local oligarchs.
Sure. There it is. Richard Ranzau, Sedgwick County Commissioner. Appreciate you coming on the show, my friend. Good luck to you in the election, and we'll talk again real soon.
Thank you very much, Andy.
Hey, appreciate it very much right there, Richard Ranzau, Sedgwick County Commissioner. 47 minutes past the hour. We'll take a break. We'll make it happen. Open line. See you when we come back as we wrap up hour number two right here on The Voice of Reason.
The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Again to Sedgwick County Commissioner Richard Ranzau joining the program. 7 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back into it. 316-721-8255. Coming up in hour number three, we do have another candidate, David Lowden. He is candidate for Judge Division number 17. We talked with one of his opponents, Linda Kirby, on the show on Wednesday and chatted with her. Look forward to chatting with Dave coming up in just a little bit. 316-721-8255. By the way, I will have, and I'll try and actually do it at the top of the hour before we go into the next. I will try and get the sample election sheet onto, scanned it onto Facebook for you, so that way you can have it, you can see it, you can share it. That way you can see exactly what the ballot may look like. Also, I said I would, and I did, on Facebook. I did share it on the Voice of Reason page. As requested, I had a lot of people requesting and asking for it, but the seats, the open house seats, where there are conservative challengers in the primary against some of the incumbent Republicans. So I shared it on the Voice of Reason page. I shared it onto the personal page as well. You can go on there. You can see a lot of people taking it, sharing it all over the place, but the districts. Now, what I did was I listed the name of the current Republican incumbent, the area and the district that they live in, and where the area actually is, in case you're not sure what area you actually are in. Their Freedom Index score, because as we mentioned, these are the majority of the ones that are not as conservative as we necessarily would like, and they haven't voted for freedom issues, and they haven't voted for pro-liberty issues. And because of that, with the grade rating from the Kansas Policy Institute, their negative grade rating, the Freedom Index score, if they have a negative sign on there, that means that they haven't really voted for pro-conservative, pro-liberty, pro-freedom agenda issues. And that's a bit of a problem. So what I did on the sheet is I listed the incumbent's name, the district they represent, the areas and towns that live within that district, their Freedom Index score, and in the name of the conservative primary challenger going into the primary election. So you can go onto Facebook, you can find that sheet, and you can share it, you can print it off, you can have it. That way you know exactly what district you live in, or if you want to make phone calls, if you want to help campaign, if you want to do something, the information is just there, and that way you can take with it and do with it as you will. But people have been wanting that, so we ended up posting it, so that way you can absolutely. You can also email me, by the way, andy@kqamradio.com. I'll send it to you that way, too, if you would like it. But between that, between the practice ballot sheet, between the excitement that we have, I am anticipating massive turnout. As you know, we've actually had higher turnout for the early election voting and early voting than we have in 10 years. This is better than 2010's turnout. This is better than 2014's turnout. This is better than 2016's early voter turnout. And that was a presidential election with Donald J. Trump on the ballot where everybody was excited. The anticipation of this election, I don't know what caused it. I don't know what the catalyst is behind this, but it is the best thing to see, is that we have massive early voter turnout. And by the way, with the early voter turnout, historically, Democrats do very, very well with early voter turnout. They're losing 2-1 right now. We have double the amount of people doing early voter turnout for us as Republicans than they do on that side of the aisle. That means that when we do show up to the actual ballot on primary day, we're going to completely obliterate the progressive side of the aisle. That means the blue wave is not going to happen. That means as long as we continue to rally around this and we move this towards the general election in a couple of months, we will have massive voter turnout. more so than we've seen from the Republican side in a really long time. And that means that we're going to maintain Republican majorities. We could potentially see and I mean, come on, who's excited right now? Show of hands. If we're seeing early voter turnout in primary elections, do you think it's because it is individuals who want the status quo and who want to vote on the same thing over and over again and who want to see more tax increases and who want to see more spending increases and who want to see the Supreme Court tell us what to do like they have been for the last 50 years? Do you want to see, is that why you're excited to vote, turn out and vote? I can't wait. I can't wait to show up and push that ballot and vote for somebody who's going to do the same thing I've seen for the last 20 years. Is that what someone's excited about? Or are we seeing high turnout, 2-to-1 ratio of Republicans over Democrats right now, because that we're fired up and we want change, that the Donald Trump environment has created an excitement in politics where we've seen an opportunity for us to do something that we haven't seen in a really long time, where we have conservative challengers challenging Republican incumbents who haven't had primary challengers in a really long time and have forgotten how to campaign against them? Is that why we're excited and turning out? Because we see an opportunity and we're making it happen. Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be the tidal wave of Republicanism, conservatism, and Republicanism in this election this year. I feel it deep in my bones. I feel it in my core. I feel we're doing something here. And I think these numbers prove it. I think with how angry the Democrats are, I think with how vicious the progressives and the Democrats have been attacking Donald Trump supporters, attacking Republicans, attacking conservatives. I think that we've had enough of that. I think they are driving us to the polls. I think opportunity has presented itself that we haven't seen in a long time where we can see change, and that is driving us to the polls. Not the same old status quo, not the same incumbent that's been voting for the same thing year over year over year, raising your taxes, cowering down to the Supreme Court. I see the change happening. And it's happening because of you, because we're excited and we're pumped up. Got to take a break. Wrap up hour number two. Now we're number three right around the corner. Dave Lowden, candidate for judge, coming up when we come back. This is The Voice of Reason.
It's time for Reason.
I mean, if he's a socialist, then being a civil rights attorney, being a lawyer, every bit of money that he brings in, he should probably donate. I mean, like all of it. He doesn't deserve any. He should be back to that level again, right? Because there are people that live at that level, and that's unfortunate for them. He should probably be living on food stamps because all the revenue and profits that he generates from his legal services, he should probably donate and give to somebody else.
This is The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I get on my knees and pray. We don't get fooled again. Don't get fooled again.
Oh, I love it. The day just keeps getting better and better. The news just keeps getting more and more entertaining. These are the days of our lives. Election time is fun. Politics is fun. It's entertaining, isn't it? I love that news story. I don't know if you heard at the top of the hour about the fact that Donald Trump having to use reverse psychology on Democrats to be able to fund the wall. Here's the reverse psychology. Fund the damn wall! It's that easy. Welcome into the Voice of Reason, broadcasting live out of the heart of the nation here in Wichita, Kansas, on the Big Talker KQAM, simulcasting on KGPT-TV as well on a free-for-all Friday. We do it every single week, but it's up to you. Phone lines are open at 316-721-8255, but whatever's on your mind today for a Friday, let's make it happen. Come on.
Baby. Yes, come on.
Ow. 316-721-8255, 316-721-TALK. If you want to join in, we have the Facebook Live feed that is up and rolling. A lot of people checking it out this morning. Welcome aboard. Great to have you there. Like it, share it, leave it onto your own page, leave a comment. Doesn't really matter. We also have TuneIn You can go to TuneIn, find KQAM Radio there as well. Lots to get to today. We still have a lot of election coverage to get to and on the phone with us to talk to us about one of them. Now, I'm learning so much. I'm fascinated by this because it's not an issue that we've necessarily talked about much or discussed, but it's extremely important to talk about, extremely important to understand when it comes to the legal system and the judiciary, which is, as you know, as we go up and up and up on the higher scales, you know, we see the Kansas Supreme Court and regional courts and district courts, and then of course the United States Supreme Court. You see some of these that judicial activism is happening quite a bit, but it starts at the local level, and it starts with, are we going to enforce the rule of law? What are we going to stand for, and how our judicial system is actually going to operate? And as you know, we have a lot of divisions that are open, two of them with contested races right now. We've talked to a few candidates throughout the week, and on the phone with us now, judge candidate for division number 17, we have Dave Lowden on the line with us. Dave, how are you, my friend?
Doing real well. Thank you for having me this morning.
Hey, I appreciate you coming on the show with us. As we mentioned, I mean, judicial races and judge races are not necessarily the focus of a lot of attention when we have governor's races and state house races and that sort of thing. But these are just as important, I think, with how we actually operate as a community. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, I definitely agree. They're, you know, to some extent, you know, we work in the background, obviously, and I think that's why people aren't aware of who we are and what we do. But when people do have something that needs to be considered and litigated, the judges play an important role because they do directly affect lives.
Mm-hmm. Talk about the importance of this seat and the judge seats that are open. What's the duties of them, the obligations? And, I mean, if you end up getting the seat, kind of what are you getting into?
Well, any judge has the obligation to, you know, hear the facts, apply the law, and follow the law. You know, it's depending on the type of case that you have, you know, that often dictates how involved the court will be. You know, for instance, in a criminal case, you know, with a judge will be driven by the law and the facts to reach a conclusion, depending on what stage of the case they're in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with civil cases, it's the same thing. But, you know, it's important for any judge when they're in court to be unbiased, to let the litigants try their case, and make sure that justice is done regardless of the type of case that they're hearing.
Sure, sure. And that's what everybody wants to see, is justice done at the end of the day. And I know I've talked about it, and as we mentioned, not necessarily at the local levels, but at the higher levels, we see this, what we call the judicial activism, where we're not necessarily enforcing the law or using the rule of law, but kind of using the emotion or what we'd like the law to be and kind of changing things a little bit. And it really brings up the question, is it difficult in today's times to enforce the law as it needs to be and interpret the law as it needs to be by what the law says? Is it difficult to do that, and we'd like to try and use our emotion at times, or is it just some people with an agenda that end up doing something like that?
I think at the local level, I think that's less of a concern. You know, district court judges aren't dictating policy. You know, there's always going to be overview by an appellate court. You know, that option will always be available. So I think from a political policy perspective, the position that I'm running for really doesn't have the avenues to dictate the kind of policy that you're talking about.
Sure.
But obviously, you know, every judge brings some type of life experience and legal experience into a case, and that will dictate oftentimes how they rule on a case. However, you know, when it comes down to it, at the district court level, we're guided by case law and precedent, And I think most judges do a good job of trying to follow that precedent rather than trying to legislate from the bench. I'm not saying that there aren't opportunities to do that, but I think those opportunities are more limited than what people would normally think of with the U.S. Supreme Court or the Kansas Supreme Court, for instance.
Sure, absolutely, absolutely. Talk about some of the cases that would present itself in that sense. I mean, we've talked about some of the criminal law, you know, civil cases would be coming up. We kind of joked earlier when we had talked about this issue that we kind of need, I think, we should have a county reality TV show, like a Judge Judy thing, to where we can actually see how, you know, some of these cases are done. But what types of cases like that within the civil side of it might present themselves, and what could you look forward to seeing?
I did hear that comment in your previous shows. that is kind of funny. I don't know that opportunity really presents itself too much in the district court. Obviously, you'd have to go through some administrative channels to even make something like that occur, and it would have to be something, I would imagine, specially set and scripted to a point, because, you know, cases don't work like that, in that fashion, where they're,
sure,
when you're just rolling one after the other in that kind of scripted fashion.
Sure. It would be entertaining, though. It would be.
It would be, but it would take a while to get something like that together. I think, the cases just don't, you know, the court doesn't work like it does on TV.
Exactly. Exactly. No, it would be entertaining. I don't see it realistically happening, but it would be fun to talk about. But those are just as an example. Those would be some of the types of civil suits that would be coming to the table of a judge in this seat. Correct. Something like that, where there's an issue with property, or there's an issue with to neighbors or that sort of thing, and the judge needs to make that decision because they can obviously settle it themselves.
Well, that does happen. In the cases, the type of cases you're talking about are more of a small claims or limited action cases where citizens are representing themselves against other citizens. That would be a small claims type situation, and that's, I think, typically what you would see on TV.
Mm-hmm.
The limited actions are where, there could be some more involvement with attorneys, but it would be difficult to have that scenario come up. So, you know, I don't know that any judge, any candidate that's running for judge right now, and if they, whichever seat that gets filled, will be dealing with those kind of cases that you're talking about on TV and those type of shows.
Sure. Talk about your background a little bit. We're talking with David Lowden, a candidate for judge, division number 17. Talk about your background, what you've done, and what's led you up to this point for the election.
My background is that I've been a 26-year prosecutor here in Sedgwick County. I've worked in every area of from district court through the appellate courts. I shouldn't say every area. I should say I've worked in every aspect of the court system, from the district court to the appellate courts. And I've even been engaged in the U.S. Supreme Court with the Carr case, Carr Brothers capital murder cases. Didn't get to argue in those cases, but it was part of the briefing process, was in court when those were argued. So most of my career has been spent doing appellate work, which means that I've practiced in front of the Kansas Court of Appeals and the Kansas Supreme Court. I've spent a career evaluating judges, criticizing them about their behavior, supporting their decisions as well, supporting the decisions made and the actions of defense attorneys, and while also attacking them. So I understand the anatomy of a case and the importance of making good decisions at the district court level. The experience that I have with that has given me the opportunity to do a lot of research and to understand what not to do as a judge, which I think is just as important as knowing what to do as a judge.
Mm-hmm.
So with that experience, I think that's what makes me the most experienced candidate for this Division 17 race.
Very good. Very good. We got just a couple of minutes left, but final words for you. Talk about yourself a little bit and the message for people going to the voting booth on Tuesday. What do you want to take away? What do you want them to take away from? And your final words to all the listeners.
What I'd like to have them take away is to do their research and determine who the best candidate is, not only by what they say, but what other people say about them. There have been numerous opportunities for people to read about my experience, whether it's the Wichita Eagle endorsement, the Bar Association evaluations, or things, we've had forums as well. And I think what that shows is there is a high level of respect for my legal abilities. It's not just me saying that. I'm endorsed by 7 retired district court judges or former district court judges. There is a distinction there, but for that purpose, it's not really relevant. But there are 7 of those judges backing me. I'm endorsed by the Friends of the FOP, Political Action Committee, that's the Fraternal Order of Police, the Firefighters Union, and of course with the Eagle endorsement, and then District Attorney Mark Benedict's endorsement too. And those endorsements don't come lightly. They come from a 26-year experience of having a good legal background and a good ethical background. I am a conservative candidate as far as my legal views, and I think that would resonate with Republican voters.
Very good. David Lowden, judge candidate, division number 17. Well, good luck to you, my friend. It is extremely important when it comes to these judge races. I know that there are, what, like 8 seats that are open right now, but 2 of them are contested, this being one of them. So it is going to be fun to see what happens on Tuesday with the ballot. David Lowden, congrats on the race. Good luck to you, and we'll look forward to chatting with you again soon.
Thank you very much.
Hey, pleasure right there. That's David Lowden, candidate for Division number 17 for judge. We'll take a break. It's open line to you for the last little bit of the show today. 21 minutes past the hour. This is the Voice of Reason.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Minutes past the hour. Welcome back into the Voice Reason. Thanks again, David Lowden, judge candidate, division number 17. Appreciate him joining the program. I'm still working on that. It is the final of the judges that we've had scheduled on the show. And we appreciate all them coming on. We will be making the judge montage. So that way, look, Election Day, Monday and Tuesday are going to be kind of unique because being that it's election time, it's kind of like celebratory holiday time. What we're going to be doing is it's going to be open lines to any candidate of any race to call in and just give a, hey, last minute shout out. The campaign was awesome. Thanks for all the support, whatever. And hey, go and vote on Tuesday. Monday and Tuesday is going to be, so any candidates at any time, you can just call in and make that happen. I'm looking forward to that. Should be fun. And on Tuesday, I will have all of the montaged candidates and all of the audio from all the candidates we've had from different races and different seats. And we'll play those coming up on Tuesday at least once an hour. So that way you can, as you go to work, listen to one more time what the candidates have to say, what their platforms are, and what they stand for to go into the voting booth and make the right choice. Making educated, informed decisions is the first step of actually making changes in our governmental system altogether. And that's what we're all about. And this is the year, as we said, it's going to be pretty exciting. 316-728-8255. By the way, I want to remind you, tonight at 7 p.m., it is the game of the night from the NBC baseball tournament at Lawrence Dumont Stadium. That is happening. Now, this tonight, starting tonight, is the championship week because we did it all last week, this whole week before, prior, and they were leading up. Now it's championship week. You got 1 week left of baseball. in the evenings here on KQAM. 1 week left. Next Saturday, the 11th, is the championship, is the final championship that you can listen to. We have the primetime game of the night every evening right here at 7 p.m. on the Big Talker KQAM. We do want to thank our sponsors for that, by the way, as well. Roden Roofing, Team Electric, Cherry Oaks Golf Course of Cheney, Davis Liquor Outlet, Midwest Kia, Fonestock Heating and Cooling, Champs Sports Bar and Grill, Shire Graphics, Just Right Auto Repair, Rusty Eck Ford, and Taco Pronto. Appreciate all those sponsors very much. So partnering up with KQAM, allowing us to do that. And by the way, during the seventh inning stretch, every night, someone gets a free burger and fries with Champ Sports Bar and Grill. Hat tip to those guys for doing that one. Stay tuned in during the game each night. During that seventh inning stretch, you can get your chance to get a nice meal over at Champ Sports Bar and Grill. We'll take a bottom of the hour break. We got lots more to get to today. Open lines to you when we come back. This is the Voice of Reason.
Republicans and Democrats accountable. This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Oh, yeah, doing the thing. Welcome into the Voice of Reason as we wrap up the program today on a free-for-all Friday. What's on your mind as we start your morning off the right way? Interpret that however you'd like to do so. 316-728-255. By the way, speaking of Riverside Cafe, appreciate those guys very much. I just got, over the break, I got a text message of a picture of the Voice of Reason on TV through KGPT TV on the TV in the Riverside Cafe restaurant. That's what I'm talking about, baby. We love you guys. Appreciate it very much. Hat tip to you guys on that one. That's fantastic. Starting off your breakfast, eating your breakfast like that early in the morning. That's the way to do it. Pretty soon, you can see it right now. I can see this Voice of Reason. Heck with CNN and the Clinton News Network. The Voice of Reason on every airport in the country. One of these days, it's going to happen. It's going to do it. I don't know about the TV thing, but you know, things are going to happen here relatively soon. Now, we love you guys down at Riverside Cafe. Appreciate that very much. And I'm glad you're watching on TV this morning while you're starting off your morning with some breakfast. Open line to you, 316-721-8255. Let's go right to them. Line number one. Good morning. What's your name?
This is Jim.
Good morning, Jim. How are you, sir?
I'm doing fine.
Good.
I was listening earlier, and Scott was on, and you guys got to discussing police misconduct and whether you could resist an arrest.
Yes.
And you said, I believe, I'm going to almost quote you, if they come breaking in, you can defend yourself against the police.
Well, not necessarily the police. I made the comment that if people break into your home, then you can defend yourself. Now, if the cops obviously have a warrant and they're coming into your house, then yeah, I wouldn't recommend you defending yourself against the cops in that sense. Okay. No.
Yeah, you can defend yourself against a home invasion. However, if the police knock on your door or they're outside and they shout police.
Sure.
And you look out the window and you see the blue and red flashing lights and stuff.
Right.
Your only choice legally in Kansas is to surrender and have a discussion with them, maybe down at the station. Because the police officers who come to your house and who will make an arrest don't necessarily know what the law is, and they don't know anything other than they've been told to go arrest somebody or there's a disturbance at some place. And their typical response is, arrest everybody and figure it out later.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to figure it out. Now, if you're in Texas, you can, if you think you're being, abused by the police, even if you know it's the police, you have a right to defend yourself against the police. Not in Kansas. In Kansas, you have to, take it into a higher level, including one of the judges we're going to elect.
Sure. Well, in the majority of situations, anyways, too, if, like you said, you look outside and you see the flashing lights and you hear the noise and you hear the police and they say, hey, you know what, we're here and either we're coming in or you need to come out here, then whatever the case is, then at that time, obviously, number one, the only reason they would do something like that is if there's a very serious situation that they have to address in the first place. If it is a mistake, then what you do is you stop whatever you're doing and you follow their instructions, and then you deal with it on the back end and say, okay, you know what, this was false, it wasn't right, and it shouldn't have happened because there's nothing actually going on, and here's why.
Here's the thing, where the real danger is. If the police get a warrant to go do an arrest, and they've been told,
sure,
in the case of the guy from California made a phone call, or in the case, say, of a burglar who's been in your house and he's trying to get himself out of trouble by turning other people in, and he just makes up a story.
Right.
And there was a case that happened years ago back in Maryland. A young burglar got arrested. He told the police about this guy that had hand grenades in his house. The police broke into the guy's house after dark, although the warrant was supposed to be served in the daytime,
mm-hmm,
by knocking on the door. But the police broke in, and the man who was living in the house came running down the stairs from his bathtub naked with a .36 caliber Civil War era pistol.
Yes!
And he got shot in the head by the ATF agents, and his hand grenades were cigarette lighters.
Well, I mean, then you have a situation like that. Now, look, just because, you know, I defend, and Jim, I appreciate it. I want to get to another phone call here as well. But just because we defend law enforcement with the actions that they take, and the majority, 95% of the time, I would say 98% of the time, their actions are legit and they have a reasonable cause for what they do, doesn't mean that they still, you know, need to pay attention as they go about it. And, of course, they're high alert, they're emotional, they're on edge as they try and go through a situation. And, you know, hopefully they make the right judgment in those cases. I, again, would like to be careful with individuals who like to criticize cops on their actions. The fact that 20/20 hindsight is always perfect when you look backwards. But when you're in the middle of the situation, unless you've actually gone through that training and you've been in those types of situations, I'm not sure how you can quite judge on those situations. And that's really what we have to remember in circumstances when law enforcement needs to go to someone's home to be able to do something. Now, you're right, and I'm glad you clarified that we brought it up to be able to clarify, is the fact that, you know, if the cops are busting down your door, do you have the right to defend yourself? Yeah, I don't know if you would or not if they're coming in to try and resolve an issue. Usually most people would take the situation of, well, if someone's breaking into my home, then I'm going to defend myself because of my stand my ground law, and you have the right to do that. That is very true. And that's the point we're trying to make. So very good. I appreciate that very much, Jim. Love the phone call. Let's go back to the lines here. Line number two. Good morning. What's your name? Hello. Going once, going twice. All right. Give me a call back. We want to hear from you. 316-721-8255. 316-721-TALK. I wanted to try and get the sample ballot onto Facebook before the show was done. I'm probably going to have to do it right after the show. I got it, scanned it to myself. Now it's a PDF version. And now, of course, Facebook doesn't accept PDF versions unless I change it into a JPEG or a picture format. So I'm going to have to do that right after the show. We will have a sample ballot on there again as we look through this. Kind of a good idea. I didn't know you could do this. And we had a caller yesterday that brought this to my attention, and I'm glad that he did, because the fact that you could go to the courthouse, you can get a sample ballot to see exactly what it's going to look like and look it over before you actually make your vote and you go to the voting booth. I think that's kind of cool. So I'll scan that. We'll get that onto Facebook right after the show. The podcast will be up shortly afterwards as well, and then we can start getting ready for election time Tuesday next week. Now, we will be doing election coverage Tuesday night. We'll be doing one or two reports that we will have a baseball game on at that time, but we will have some updates intermittently during the commercial breaks during the baseball game to give you some updates on what's happening during election time, during the primary, and as the precincts start rolling in throughout, 9, 10 o'clock or so, we will have some updates on that one. So stay tuned in. Election coverage right here on KQAM. Yours truly will be doing that, of course, with the show Tuesday morning, getting you fired up and ready to go to election booths. Let's go back to the phones, take another phone call here. Line number three. Good morning. What's your name?
Don.
Hey, good morning, Don. How are you?
Yeah, I got a question about Ron E.M. Estes.
Okay.
Can we run that guy down and ask him a few questions?
That would be nice. He has done, as far as I'm aware, two interviews the entire time that he's been, quote unquote, running for office. He said that he has been doing grassroots campaigning. The last time I went to his website, there were no, really, it was just one page saying that he was running, but no platform, no issues, no discussion, no nothing. I haven't seen any campaign ads for him. I have seen nothing on him. And the two interviews that he did were very brief. And at the beginning, for the first month or two, when he announced, his wife was the one taking the phone call, so no one could even talk to him.
I'd like to know if he's been paid by anybody in particular to run for office.
Well, that would be a really good question. Now, what we can do is look back at his history, and historically, him and his wife over the last couple of years have donated to Barack Obama's campaign back in 2012. They donated to James Thompson's campaign. The Democrat running against James Thompson, or run against Ron DeSantis last year, they donated to Paul Davis's campaign for an election, a Democrat as well. So they've been staunch supporters of progressive Democrats for a long time. And from what it sounds like, is that his wife is a little more politically active than even he is. So maybe it was her idea to get him on the ballot just to try and confuse some voters.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise. It's kind of funny all that it turns out, isn't it?
Well, I'm also wondering, well, where's he live and where's he work?
That's a good question, too. I don't know. I'm sure we could look up his address and take a look, but maybe he needs to answer some questions. I mean, with the election on Tuesday, the fact that we haven't seen, look, I have not seen a single yard sign that said Ron M. Estes at all in any way, shape, or form. I've not heard of any door knocking. I haven't received any phone calls. I haven't received any literature in the mail. I've seen nothing from Ron M. Estes. It's only there to catch people off guard when they go to the voting booth and accidentally hit the wrong one and hope that it disrupts the election process.
Mm-hmm. Isn't it funny how everybody's screaming about voter fraud? Mm-hmm. You get it. Just don't do anything about it.
Exactly. See, voter fraud right in front of our face. Where they're doing it legally, they're just doing it in a really dirty way.
Is there a good place? You just mentioned something that was really important.
Sure.
About the looking at the ballots before you vote.
Yes. So if
you're a good place, you can go to, I've gone through the secretary's page and it takes forever. Somebody was asking me who they need to vote for in their area. And I said, I only know my area.
Sure. There is a list on the Secretary of State's website where you can go and you can see every candidate in the state and what seat they're running for and if they're a Republican or Democrat. And I believe it even has some of their personal info on their contact info. But you can go to the Secretary of State's website and you can look up elections and you can click on, you know, the primary, and it'll come up with the entire list of every candidate. For the ballot itself, you can go to actually the courthouse and you can request a sample ballot of exactly what the ballot looks like with everybody on there in your area and what races are going to be held. So that way you can look it over before you go to the voting booth and you can see exactly what the ballot will look like.
Interesting. What if you go to the courthouse for early voting? How are they going to know what your district in? I guess they figure that all out.
Yeah, I guess you could ask them for the one specifically for your district or for your party, if you're Republican, Democrat sort of thing. You could ask them. But this one, a listener actually brought this by yesterday to me, and it was just County of Sedgwick County, Republican Party, August 7th, and they just printed off a sample ballot for the Republicans for the primary race. So you can go and you could probably give them your info and they can pull up the right one for you.
Okay, well, thanks. I love your show.
Hey, thank you. I appreciate it very much, Don. Appreciate the phone call. We got about just a minute before we need to take a break here, but let's try and sneak in another phone call here, shall we? Good morning. What's your name?
Hey, Sean here.
What's going on, Sean?
Not know much. Hey, you know what the M stands for in Ron M. Estes?
What's that?
It stands for Mystery Man.
Ah, see, Mystery Man right there. I would agree with that. We know nothing about this guy. How are we supposed to vote for somebody that we know nothing about?
Well, it's just the Democrats, you know. They can't win an election fair and square. They got to cheat. But I tell you what I'm going to do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to check with my contacts in Russia, find out who this guy is.
Ah, there you go. You know what? They might have a little more info on him than we do. They may have just a little bit more information on Ron M. Estes with the Russians. Sean, I love it, my friend. Appreciate it very much. We got to take a break here. So we'll come back, wrap up the show. We'll try and sneak in a few more phone calls on The Voice of Reason here on a free-for-all Friday.
You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
by the way, I got a bunch of messages from individuals, Facebook and text messages about different websites you can go, and you can actually see some sample ballots for you. They're a lot easier than even driving to the courthouse. Obviously, everything's on the interweb. The Kansas Secretary of State's office, or the website, the best one to go to if you want to see a sample ballot for your area. Here's the website, and I'll share a link on this throughout the show or throughout the social media today as well. But myvoteinfo.voteks.org. myvoteinfo.voteks.org. Go to that website. You can select on the actual county that you want and the primary, and you can see everything. You can see the polling places. You can see your district and a sample ballot right there, just for your information. This portion of The Voice Reason brought to you by the Inman Harvest Cafe. It is your Fried Chicken Friday, baby. 112 South Main Street, downtown Inman. Get your fill of your fried chicken today, because that's the perfect way to start off your weekend, just north of Hutch in Inman. Give them a call, 620-585-6925. Katie's on the line with us. And Katie, how many good, wonderful smells are you having in the kitchen there?
Well, right now I am smelling bacon and onions and butter, because I'm sautéing them up on the grill to go into our green beans that are on the buffet today. So that's what I'm smelling right this second.
That's kind of what I'm talking about. I like that right there. So you guys have two major buffets today, actually. This is your one of the long days that you have, because you're there.
It's a long day.
it is a little bit with a nice long day with a buffet from 11 to 1. Usually the rest of the week you kind of close at 2. Today you're open until 5 to 8 o'clock for the big buffet tonight.
Right.
And lots of goodies. What's on the slate for today?
So today we're having German lasagna. So that's German sausage that we get down the street here at the grocery store. And then we slice that up, and it's got sauerkraut, and then there's a saucy stuff that we make. And then that goes, you know, layered with lasagna noodles, like, you know, a lasagna.
Sure.
with mozzarella cheese. And then we're also going to have a zucchini and yellow squash casserole that's got it's got chicken, it's got onions and celery and carrots and all kinds of great stuff in there. And then it's got a topping, like stuffing on top.
Yeah,
and then for lunchtime, we're going to fix up here a breakfast casserole with sausage and eggs and cheese and bacon and for lunch. But then at supper time from 5 to 8, we will have our famous roast beef out there instead of the breakfast casserole. So
very good. I dig it. And, I mean, you kind of have the wide range of whatever you're in the mood for, whether it is the fried chicken and the goodies, or whether it's something healthy like the zucchini and squash. I mean, you kind of have some great alternatives.
We try to have something for everybody. Of course, you know, there are people out there in the world that are like, you know, vegans and they don't eat, or people who they're forced to eat gluten-free for whatever dietary reason that they have. And we try to accommodate as many people as we can, just ask lots of questions. We're always happy I never want anybody to leave here hungry.
Exactly.
Ever.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See,
yeah.
I like that. Now, we got to remind everybody, coming up from 5 to 8 o'clock for the buffet tonight, you do get your free slice of pie as you're trying to sit down, because I know everybody's there and excited. You know, you can kind of stand up and munch on your slice of pie while you're getting your table, sort of thing.
You could.
Yeah, you could potentially. It's really good. Get a nice thing of ice cream. Anyways, what is the type of pies you guys have lined up for you today?
So today we have, and I'll read them backwards this time because I read them frontwards last time. So we got peach, pumpkin, custard, cherry, lemon meringue, rhubarb custard, sour cream, raisin, peanut butter, chocolate, and coconut.
Very good. I love it. I love it. Coconut. Now, that's usually, I mean, the coconut. I haven't had a coconut pie in a really long time. I'm sure that's one of the more popular items, isn't it?
It is. And in fact, it's the most popular, which is why it's always first on the list.
See?
Because it's always there. We make zillions and zillions of coconut pies.
Exactly.
Lots of coconut.
Lots of coconut pies. Now, you mentioned before about trying to test out some new flavored ice creams. How's that bumbleberry ice cream going along?
Well, you know what? With Nick's campaign this summer, to be honest, Andy, we have not had time to make bumbleberry ice cream yet, because we've been in just a stinking lot of counties.
That is very true. And so, I'm glad you guys are doing that, and we've talked about it on the air a little bit with Nick, you know, running for the first congressional district there on the western part of the state. I think it's a great campaign, and I know you guys have been doing a lot of grassroots stuff, so good luck to you guys. It's going to be great.
Yes. Shameless plug, okay? Vote Nick Reinecker, August 7th, first congressional district. Just saying.
There you go.
For the TimeForNick.com.
Exactly. Time for the Big Red First right there, Nick Reinecker. So
yes.
Good luck to you guys. It is the Inman Harvest Cafe, 112 South Main Street, downtown Inman. We appreciate it very much. You guys enjoy. We'll chat with you again next Friday.
Thanks, Andy. Talk to you then.
Always a pleasure right there. Brought to you by the Inman Harvest Cafe. We appreciate those guys very much. So wrapping up the program, it's all said and done. I can't believe it goes by way too fast. Everybody have a wonderful, tremendous pre-election weekend. Get out, do some door knocking, make some phone calls. Get pumped up for this election because it's coming hard and heavy on Tuesday, and we'll be there to cover it. This is your show. It's time to speak up, speak out, speak loud, speak proud, speak the truth, and always speak some reason. This is the Voice of Reason.